friends. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 to 18. Peter begins the passage in the most undeterred way, totally unflustered by the events that was happening around about him. He seems like a father calmly quieting his excited children who are calling out one thing and another about an event that's just occurred. Of course, that event in this case was the scoffers who had entered the church and were not only mocking the very idea of the second coming of Jesus, but in fact laughing at it. Peter, by using the word beloved at the beginning of the chapter, calms the spirit of his readers as well as our own. The Greek word that's used here is better translated as dear friends. Peter uses the term not once but three times in the chapter in verses 1, 8 and 15. Jeremy Taylor, the Church of England cleric who achieved fame as an author during the rule of Oliver Cromwell, once said, "By friendship you mean the greatest love, the greatest usefulness, the most open communication, the noblest of suffering, the severest of truth, the hardiest of counsel, and the greatest union of minds of which brave men and women are capable." One example of friendship was that of Pee Wee Reese and Jack Robinson. In his first season with the Brooklyn Dodgers, Jack Robinson was the first black man to play Major League Baseball. He faced venom everywhere he traveled. Fastballs at his head, spikes on the bases, brutal racial slander from the opposing dugouts and from the crowds. During one game in Boston, the taunts and racial slurs seemed to reach a peak. He stood on second base, totally humiliated, while the fans jeered him. In the midst of this, another Dodger, a southern white man by the name of Pee Wee Reese, called timeout, and he walked from his position from shortstop towards Robinson on second base, put his arms over Robinson's shoulder and faced the crowd. The fans grew quiet as Pee Wee stood there for what seemed to be a very long time with Jack Robinson. This gesture spoke more eloquent than any other words as Pee Wee Reese demonstrated that this man is my friend. As we read this chapter, we feel the warmth of Peter's friendship reaching out to each of us like an arm slung over our shoulders, standing alongside us, silencing the scoffers, saying to the entire world, Peter is saying that we are his dear friends. Then in the most unique way, Peter shares with us his friends as why the scoffers are wrong. It's unique in that he deals with the hope of all the saints, which is the coming of Christ, but he deals with it in a prophetic manner. Peter, under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, races us through time and history, highlighting events that concern him and his readers about the coming of Christ. Section A, the purpose of this letter. We can see that Peter took a deep interest in the spiritual welfare of his readers. He also had a great affection for them, for he calls them beloved. Peter is an example to every Christian of diligence and affectionately caring for each other's souls. He then goes on to tell them the reason why he's writing to them in the second epistle, which is to stir up their minds. Now, the power of memory is perhaps the most amazing part of our intellectual being. We all use the past to build the future. Memory gives us building blocks to plan and predict, to dream, to fantasize, and to divine who we are in this universe. Stringing together bits and pieces of our past knowledge, we are able to grow. Elvis Presley sang a song titled Memories, in which he tells how memories are pressed between the pages of our minds. Memories are like a gold thread that links our childhood with our present, upon which hangs the pearls, the facts and experiences of a lifetime. Memories has a servant, and the name is recollection, an invisible librarian running about the chambers of our minds, attempting to find the thing that it was called to locate, those sweet memories, as Elvis puts it, that are pressed between the pages of our minds. Peter calls us to awaken the servant of our memory, recollection, and to search amongst the library chambers of our memory to find those teachings that we have pressed between the pages of our minds. Peter calls our minds pure, which in the Greek means that it is flawless, that it may be held up to the sunlight and be found flawless. We can say that Peter gives his readers a compliment. He appeals to his readers as people who have had their minds uncontaminated by heresy and unbelief and lustful desires. He's telling them and also us that they and we are really fine and splendid people. To Peter, these readers were like jewels that had been rescued from the mud and mire into which some had fallen. The necessity of stirring up their pure mind was that they would be mindful of certain issues of the Christian faith, which is well documented in the writings of the Old Testament prophets and the apostles, in order that they would be safeguarded against the heresies and immorality of false teachers mentioned in the previous chapter, and safeguard against the scoffers whom he mentions in this chapter. Section B, the taunt of the scoffers, chapter 3, verses 3 to 4. However, Peter tells us in verse 3 that we should not be alarmed at what they, the scoffers, are saying. For it's well known in the last days, that is the events between Christ's first and second coming, that there will be quite a lot of scoffers who will come and make such rash, unthinking statements. Due to their totally corrupt, immoral behavior, scoffers or mockers will come, and they are described as walking according to their lust. There have always been people who've mocked those who've trusted in God. Peter is speaking about the same people as in chapters 1 and 2. These false teachers. These ones who like to walk after their own lust. They were people who have rejected the faith. And because they were unwilling to believe, any teaching concerning the second coming was repulsive and disgusting and distasteful to them. Their sensual living and life was blinding their spiritual understanding. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 14 says, "But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned." These scoffers were carrying on as they do today, saying, "Hey, where is the coming of Jesus? And where are all those catastrophe changes that you said would take place?" Though our fathers, that is the Old Testament prophets and the early church fathers of the church, believed in such things, well, it's not happened. Look, things have not changed. They are as they have been since creation. Things are stable. And there has not been even a hint that something major will happen. Why should we concern ourselves with holy living? Let's get on with whatever makes us feel good. The book Isaac Storm by Eric Larson is an interesting book about a hurricane that devastated Galveston, Texas in 1900. One of the main plots of the line of the book is how everyone was convinced that the hurricane would never strike Galveston, even as one approached. The author vividly describes how the streets became flooded. People went about their business as if nothing was wrong. Children played in the water. Men gathered for breakfast in the local diner. No one fled from the storm that was about to strike. Some didn't worry about it because Isaac Klein, the National Weather Service officer of Galveston, assured them that it was not a severe storm. Others simply believed that Galveston was invincible. Some thought that since they had never seen a hurricane in Galveston, one never would. For a number of reasons, people assured themselves that nothing bad would happen, and the result, 6,000 people died on the 8th of September 1900. Today we can see the storm clouds of Christ's second coming forming on the horizon. There is a moral and spiritual decline that continues to erode the lives of people. The warning signs are there for all to see. They call us to return to the Lord and to seek refuge in Him. Like the citizens of Galveston in 1900, people, the scoffers, refuse to believe it will ever happen. Section C, the stability of God, chapter 3, verses 5 to 9. Peter, in these verses, refutes the mockers by asserting the stability of God, firstly by pointing out the stability of God's word, then the stability of God's time and love. On his expedition to the Antarctic, Ernest Shackleton was compelled to leave some men on Elephant Island with the intention of returning for them and taking them back to England. Three times he tried to reach them, but his efforts ended in failure. When he finally reached them, he was delighted to find that the men were not only alive, but all prepared to get aboard the ship. They were soon on their way to safety and home. After the excitement ended, Shackleton inquired how it was that they were ready to get aboard so promptly. He was told that every morning their leader, Frank Wild, rolled up his sleeping bag and said, "Get your things ready, boys. The boss could come today." Shackleton was gone for 128 days. Frank Wilder was left in the most despondent conditions to lead the remainder of the team. All the men suffered from various illness. The food supply of penguins ran dangerously short. They were faced with the possible chance of being overtaken by natural disasters from which they as a group or individuals were unable to extract themselves. No doubt to the men left behind on Elephant Island, each day would felt like 1,000 years. Yet in all of this, Frank Wilde excelled as a leader. In what could only be the most difficult of conditions, he maintained an infusion into the men, an optimistic belief that they would be rescued. Each morning, he woke the men with a cheery shout, "Lash up, boys, and stow. The boss may come today." One of the team members, Audley Lees, stated it was a fine thing that Wilde was able, in such a despondent environment, to maintain their spirits. Peter, like Frank Wilde, and like all church leaders, is in the most difficult situation, awakens us with a confident shout and encouragement. "Lash up and get ready, church. The boss, the Lord, may come today." Jesus said these words, "Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." These words are so very simple, but oh, what depth of feeling, sense of closeness, height of glory and hope they contain. In a very concise and powerful way, Christ's words embody our hope. This same living hope about which Peter speaks in both of his letters. The stability of God's word, chapter 3, verses 5 to 7. Let's begin by looking at the stability of God's word. Peter starts with the scoffers and is quite adamant that the scoffers have willfully chosen to ignore the most prominent discussion of that time amongst Christians, which was, as God had chosen to create the world out of water, things have not always been stable, and there's no guarantee that the world would remain stable. Now we find in Genesis chapter 1 that God's Spirit moved upon the face of the deep, and then by the power of his word, God caused the water to be divided and the dry land to rise up. Then God chose to sustain his creation with water. Because of the wickedness of humanity, he chose to destroy the world by that which he created, a deluge of water. And this deluge came at the time of Noah. The Bible tells us in Genesis 6, that the wickedness of humanity was so great that God regretted making humanity. And he reached out and searched for one righteous man who could relay his warning concerning the coming destruction upon the earth. And God found Noah, warned him of the coming destruction, and told him firstly to go and to prepare for it by building an ark of safety for himself and his family. Secondly, God told Noah to go and to tell the world of the coming judgment of the deluge of water. And if they repented of their sins, then they would be saved, safe in the ark with Noah's family. However, none chose to believe Noah's preaching, saying that such things was not possible. Now the longer that Noah preached, and he preached the message for 120 years, the more and more they were convinced of the stability of the earth and that his message was false. In fact, they laughed and mocked at his message, treating it as a senile old man. However, when the time was up, Noah was told by God to go into the ark. Then it began to rain, and it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. The Bible tells us that the fountains of the deep broke up in Genesis 7. Peter says that the world was flooded with water. The picture that's painted here is of the subterranean ocean suddenly breaking up and their waters rushing across the earth with one huge sheet like a great tidal wave. Now, we don't know how this happens. However, scientists tell us that the Mediterranean Sea was formed when water from the Atlantic Ocean breached the mountain ranges between Europe and Africa, and the floods moved at more than 100 kilometers per hour, scarring the shores of the seabed, which is still visible today. Also, tsunamis are waves caused by sudden movements of the ocean surface, due to earthquakes and volcanic eruptions on the seafloor. Perhaps similar things like this happened all over the world, causing subterranean oceans to suddenly break open. Peter then continues in verse 7 to point out that the same word, that is the word of God, that drew the earth out of the water and had it destroyed by water, has now kept in store within the world's inner depth and within the heavens that which would destroy the earth, which is fire. Just as the heavens and the earth, God once before held that which would destroy the earth, water. Now, Peter's conviction that the world will be destroyed by fire is not based upon superstition or the rantings of an old man, but upon the same word of God that formed the world and now comes through the voice of the prophets in the Old Testament, who stand in time, as Noah once stood, warning of God's destruction upon the unrepentant. The difference between Noah and prophets such as Isaiah, Joel, Naaman, and Malachi is that the destruction upon the earth of which they warn is not by water, but by fire. Now, if God honors his word by the mouth of one of his prophets, Noah, then he will surely honor his word by the mouth of many prophets. The warning is abundantly clear to the believer that we are not to be drawn into the snare of mockers who seek to lull us and others into a sense of false security by their arguments that all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation, for this is not true. There is only one stable thing, and this is God's word. His word declares that Jesus Christ will come again, and the world will be destroyed by fire in judgment, and only those who've put their trust in Jesus will be saved. As we stand at the threshold of the great harvest, God is calling the church today, like Noah, allowing his word to flow through us, the same word that created the world, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, that men and women might be saved from such judgment. It's only through the knowledge that men and women find the one who saves them. Section 2, the stability of God's timing and love. Chapter 3, verses 8 to 9. Peter continues to point out in verses 8 and 9 that seemingly the delay in the coming of Christ is because God sees time in a perspective that we lack and with an intensity of love that we lack. These, however, two important issues that we need to come to grips with. The first one is God's perspective of time. God's perspective of time is so different from ours. As he governs the laws of nature and can create and destroy them at his will, so too he governs the laws of time. Time, like nature, neither governs God nor is necessary to his existence. In the backdrop of eternity, 1,000 years will be only as a day. This is seen so clearly in the life of Noah. Though God told Noah 3 times that he would destroy mankind, and although his words carried a sense of urgency, he allowed Noah 120 years to build the ark. Why? So that Noah would have a perfect ark of safety. So one of the reasons for the delay of Christ's coming is to allow time for the perfecting of the saints. Now the Apostle John in Revelation chapter 19 verses 7 to 8 also speaks of the perfecting of the saints when he speaks of the marriage of the Lamb. He says the marriage of the Lamb has come and his wife has made herself ready or prepared herself for the coming of Christ. He tells us that it's granted unto the bride of Christ to be clothed in clean, fine, white linen. And the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. The word righteous, when used here, refers to the saints rather than the righteousness of God. In the Greek, it means righteous deeds. And because of this, it refers to the deeds of the saints. And it's in the plural, which means many individuals are involved. The verse clearly points that we are not saved by our works of righteousness, only by grace. Yet it does show that our personal righteousness, that is our walk before the Lord, has a great purpose which aids in the manufacture of the fine linen that the bride wears on that great day. At the royal wedding of Prince Andrew and Sarah, the best kept secret was Sarah's wedding dress. Many individuals were involved in its manufacture. Many of those involved had no idea what the finished product would look like. Yet this did not dampen their enthusiasm, for they all worked hard, knowing that their contribution counted as something great. Finally, it was come together, and Sarah was granted permission to wear it on that great day of her life, the 23rd of July, 1986. Now, the wedding gown did not make her more the wife of Prince Andrew, but it did present the image of a perfect wife that he designed. And so it is with us. We are all involved in the greatest kept secret the world has ever known, the manufacture of the fine white linen garment that the bride of Christ shall be granted permission to wear on that day of Christ's coming. So then, the seeming delay of Christ's coming is firstly for the church, that we may be a perfect bride that God desires for his Son. 2.2, the intensity of God's love. Because of his love for humanity and wishing that none should perish, God views time with an intensity that we lack. This is seen by the fact that to the Lord 1,000 years is as a day. Though time does not exist to God, in our perspective, 1 hour in God's time is equal to 41 years and 8 months of our time, which is but a speck in eternity. So in God's thinking, and against all eternity, he has only a fleeting moment into which to make his love abundantly clear to that individual. The intensity of God's love is seen in God holding open the door of the ark and calling Noah and his family to come inside. The intensity of God's love is picked up in Revelation 3:20, where Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens, I will come into him." The appeal is personal and individual. If others as a whole will not heed Christ's warning, the individual is given an opportunity to respond. The appeal echoes with the love of the Good Shepherd who knows each one of his sheep by name. Though God has allowed time for the perfecting of the saints, the intensity and stability of his love for humanity remains the same. Why? It's because his word remains stable. Let us not succumb to the taunts of the scoffers, but preach the word with enthusiasm, reverence, remembering the stability of God's word and love for humanity and his perfecting grace in each of our lives. Section D, our attitude towards end time events, chapter 3, verses 10 to 12. Peter, having assured us of the stability of God, now turns his attention to our attitude towards end time events and the believer's conduct in light of such knowledge. On section 1, the end time events, chapter 3, verse 10 and 12b. Peter says, "The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night." They are the same words that Jesus used to describe his coming in Matthew and Luke's gospel, and how Paul describes Christ's coming in 2 Thessalonians. The phrase carries an idea of an unexpected surprise and a loss suffered by those who are unprepared for the catastrophe of a burglary at night. Just as a thief does not announce their coming, neither will Christ announce his coming. Peter, like the other apostles, assures us that at the coming of Christ there will be a great cosmic destruction on a scale never ever seen or conceived in our wildest imaginations. The first thing that will happen is that the heavens will pass away with a great noise. Now the phrase "great noise" is a very colorful phrase. In the Greek it's the swish of an arrow through the air, or the sound of the mighty wind, or the roaring of waves, or the roaring of a destructive flames, or an all-consuming fire. Next, Peter says that the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in will be burned up. Elements in the ancient world refer to stars, planets, and galaxies. And so these words describe an apocalyptic event. Isaiah described it as this in Isaiah 34, "All of the host of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heaven shall roll up as a scroll." John also, in John chapter 20 of Revelation, verses 11 to 15, speaks of the same event. He says that he had an awe-inspiring vision of a great white throne which dominated the total scene. There was no mention of the one who sat upon the throne, yet so great is his majesty that heaven and earth flew away. They disappear before him. He says, and there was no place for them. Meaning that they dissolved before his purity like ice on a hot plate. The identity of the one who sat upon the throne is none other than God. John tells us that after the heaven and earth passed away, the dead, the great and the small, stand before the throne. He also saw the sea, death and hell, giving up the dead for judgment. The description is all-inclusive, all-embracing all humanity. There are none so great to escape, none so important that can be missed, none so hidden that cannot be found. They all stand waiting for judgment to be passed. John tells us that both hell and death are thrown into the lake of fire, and so are those whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Peter and also John has not only confronted us with the fact that there is no other power stronger than God's power, not even hell or death, but he's woken within us a concern to consider our attitude towards God in the light of such things, in spite of what the scoffers may say. Section 2. What should our attitude be? Chapter 3, verses 11 to 12. Peter continues with a wise pastor's heart. This is not only causes us to reflect upon our attitude we should have in light of the precarious existence in which we find ourselves, but also challenges us what to do about it. He says, what manner of persons ought you be? Now the phrase, what manner of persons, in the Greek literally means of what country? In other words, by what citizenship should we allow ourselves to be governed? Will we know that we can meet the Lord at any time? Do we want the citizenship of this world or of heaven? To Peter, the fact that the day of the Lord can come upon us was so unexpectedly means that there can be one, but one citizenship that should govern our lives, the citizenship of heaven. This citizenship is characterized by three things. First is holy conduct, and it refers to someone who has no affection for this unstable world and its delusions, but has set themselves apart for a wholehearted service to God. Secondly, we are to be like those who pursue godliness, with a fervor and a desire of a man hunting down a deer that will become his winter meat supply. There can be no slackness in this kind of pursuit. Thirdly, we are not to have a passive expectation of the coming of our Lord, but an active and passionate expectation. Peter says, looking for and hasting on the coming of the day of the Lord. The word hasting here means to urge on, like a jockey riding on a horse in a great race towards the finishing line. We hasten on the day of the Lord by our own preparation, making ourselves ready as the bride of Christ, pursuing godliness by serving God, by preaching the gospel to all, knowing that God does not wish that any should perish. It is in these verses that we come to the realization that Peter is dealing with a far greater issue than the destruction of this world. He's dealing with the quality of life that we are to live in light of the dissolving world. Since we have no idea when Christ will return, then we are to not allow the scoffers to rob us of our heavenly citizenship or any part of its characteristics. We are called to be an ambassador for Christ, who permanently display our heavenly citizenship to all, in contrast to the unpredictability of our circumstances and in this world that will one day dissolve. Section E, the promise to the saints, chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. A pastor visited an older man. The pastor said, at your age, you should be thinking about the hereafter. Well, the old man replied, oh, I do all the time, Pastor, no matter where I am, in the living room, upstairs, in the kitchen, and down in the basement. I ask myself, what am I hereafter? Peter now speaks about what awaits the saints in the hereafter. Building upon the assured promise that God cannot lie, Peter reminds us of the wonderful divine promise of 13 and 14 verses, that these terrifying events of which he has spoken is either preludes to the new heaven and new earth in which the saints will dwell forever, and of our diligent need to prepare for it. Section 1, the dwelling place of the saints described, verse 13. By the Spirit of God, Peter in verse 13 sees the whole new heaven and earth, very distinct from the old heaven and the old earth that will pass away. The Apostle John also saw the same thing in Revelation 21. He says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the word new in the Greek means freshness. John, like Peter, was not looking at a new addition of the same thing, but rather a complete transformation of all things, a fresh new start. By the Spirit, both men saw God moving with the energy of His almighty creative power, moving and creating a new heaven and a new earth. The freshness and newness is particularly stressed by John as he tells us that there is no sea in this place. Now, in the ancient world, the sea was always a symbol of change, a place of unrest. Isaiah the prophet described the wicked as being like a troubled sea. It was also considered a place out of which rose evil. John described the Antichrist coming out of the sea in Revelation 13. Now, John makes it quite clear in Revelation 21 that there will be no appearance of evil in this place. No longer will we chart the course of our lives upon the seas of unlimited evil and unrest. All of this shall be swept away, and we will enter into a new world that contains the complete rest of God. What a wonderful place God has planned for the righteous, the saints of God. Jesus said these words of hope. He said, "Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, and there also you may be." There is some interesting things to note about the words of Jesus. He begins by saying, "In my Father's house are many mansions." The word mansions can also be translated as abiding places. There are two beautiful promises flowing through these words. Some translators use the word mansions because they not only wanted to convey Jesus' assurance to us that there was more than ample room for all believers with him in heaven, but they wanted to capture the hope that Jesus was imparting to the disciples. Did the Jews always have a hope of the abiding place in God? Yet this hope that Jesus offers is far beyond that imagined by the Jewish fathers and prophets of the Old Testament. The word abide, as used by John here, is one of his favorite words. In the Greek, it speaks of an enduring relationship. It also means to take up permanent residence, to make a settled home. It refers to a place of intimate fellowship. According to Bible scholars, the word abide was a technical word used by the rabbis at that time. The rabbis believed that when 10 people sat together and occupied themselves with the Torah, the Shekinah glory of God abides on them. The underlying principle in the passage is that Christ is going to heaven to prepare a place for us that where His presence, His glory abides amongst us. Jesus Himself tells us that He's going to prepare such a place. Now, the word prepare, as used here, is a word used for perfectly fitting clothes. There's nothing more uncomfortable than purchasing a pair of shoes that are too small or a shirt or blouse that's too tight. Jesus assures us that He's putting His resources into preparing a place that is not only filled with His glory, but perfectly fits us as individuals. Jesus is telling us that He will return for us. The scriptures describe Christ's return as a triumphant king coming in all His glory, accompanied by a host of angels. However, in this passage, John adds another image to the coming of Christ. The image in the Greek is called a prodromos, which was the name given to the ancient captains of pilot boats, who were sent out from the port to meet great grain ships of the ancient world to guide them safely into a port, just as a captain of a pilot boat guides great ocean-going cargo ships safely into port. The concept that John is portraying here is of Jesus one day returning as our ship's pilot to bring us safely home. Warren Salzman, numerous paintings of Christ have brought inspiration to millions of people. His portrait of Christ, our pilot, comes from his experience as a young man sailing on calm seas when suddenly a great storm rolled in and nearly overwhelmed him. During the storm, he felt the presence of Christ with him, guiding him safely home. Later, he stated that what he learned from the experience was that with Christ as one's pilot, no matter the danger, one's life will be kept. One will be led safely into the harbor of God's eternal kingdom. And this is the picture that's painted in the Gospel of John and in Peter's epistle, that Christ is our great pilot who will lead us safely into the harbor of God's eternal kingdom. Section 2, being ready to greet Jesus, chapter 3, verse 14. Peter then continues that in light of the fact that we are looking forward to being founded by Christ at his coming, that we are to be in peace without spot and blameless. Now, peace as used here describes the attitude of the believer as they meet the Lord without shame. Those without Christ will stand before the great right throne of judgment, both in fear and shame. However, we will stand before Christ at his coming in perfect peace. Why? It's because our sins have been pardoned and our peace has been made with God through Jesus Christ. Peter says that we are to be without spot and blameless. At the coming of Christ, we are to reflect his perfect character. As Christ was the spotless and blameless Lamb of God, so we are now to live lives that do not conform to the image of this world, but conform in every way to the image of God's dear Son, Jesus. By firstly, without spot, and secondly, without blemish. And in the Greek, it implies a condition where no just cause of complaint can be raised against someone. It's interesting to note that the early Christians of Thessalonica had inscribed upon their tombs, preserved blameless till his coming. Let us have such a thing written upon our lives today, not only because we flee from the sin of immorality, but all sin, so that in spite of what the scoffers may say, at Christ's coming, that we may be ready. Section F, to support his teaching, Peter quotes from Paul, chapter 3, verses 15 to 16. Peter brings his thoughts together in the conclusion, doing two things. First, he points out that the Apostle Paul, according to the wisdom he received from God in his writing, agrees with Peter that the Lord has delayed his return to give opportunity for others to repent and to find Christ as Savior and thus be saved. And secondly, quite amazing to the Jews, he attributes the same divine inspiration of Paul's writing as being equal to those writings of the Old Testament prophets. He does this by stating that the scoffers and heretics have taken Paul's writings, where he spoke of similar things as Peter, as well as other subjects, and because they found them difficult to understand, they twisted them as they did with other scriptures, no doubt support their evil lives. The fact that Peter continues by saying that the twisting and perverting of Paul's writings would eventually bring destruction upon those unlearned, unstable heretics further supports his strong belief that the same Holy Spirit who inspired the prophets of old had actively inspired Paul's writings. Section G, Grow in Grace, chapter 3, verses 17 to 18. Peter addresses them for the final time as beloved because he wishes to stress to them that his final exhortation given to them is with the greatest affection and concern for their eternal well-being. The exhortation is split into two parts. The first part is found in verse 17, in which Peter urges his readers, you and I, not to be swept off their feet by evil and seducing heretics whom they will no doubt encounter. For not only have they been well forewarned about these heretics' subtle errors, immoral lifestyle, and false philosophies, but they have also been well equipped to resist these ones. The relationship between behavior and knowledge is brought out by the word steadfast, which in the Greek is used to describe the fixed position of stars and the steadiness of a beam of light. The thought that seems to be betrayed is that Peter, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, wishes to fix his readers in an unshakable position, like stars, that they therefore are able to produce a constant light of the gospel into a world that's overcome with darkness, in order that, in the time that we have left, before the Lord's return, that men and women might be saved. Now, the second half of the exhortation is found in the final verse of the letter. Peter commands us to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord. To Peter, the Christian life is like riding a bike. Unless you keep moving, you will fall off it. Thomas Mogenen, the founder and president and chief executor of Domino's Pizza, from 1970 to 1985, Domino's grew from a small debt-ridden chain to become the second largest pizza company in America. When asked to account for the phenomenal growth of his company, he explained, "I program everything for growth." Peter is telling us that everything in the Christian life is to be programmed for growth. The Christian life is a developing life, and that develop and growth must take place in two areas. First, in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace refers to God's divine favor. Just as a tree flourishes under the influence of sunlight and rain, so we as Christians flourish under the divine favor of God upon our lives through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is our responsibility to remain under the influence, not to be drawn into error. Next, we are to grow in knowledge. It is generally agreed amongst Bible scholars that the word knowledge is used here in the sense of a personal acquaintance with Jesus. So, just as a personal encounter was necessary to begin the Christian life, it is essential to maintain it. Okay. Peter ends the letter with a quite unusual doxology to Jesus. For not only does he ascribe the glory to Jesus, but the Greek word means splendor, which refers to the radiance of Christ in glory. But he also indicates the period of time in which this glory is to be given, both now and in the future. The word now refers to the fact that a believer must now give glory and praise to Christ, for we are in debt to him for the knowledge of eternal life. Yet this praise does not subside at the end of time, as we know it, but continues on for all eternity. Peter says forever. Now, it's agreed amongst Bible scholars that the word forever is a difficult word to explain, because the literal translation of the Greek is for the day of the age or of eternity, which refers to the day that eternity begins, but unlike other days, this day will last for all eternity. St. Augustine explained it this way. It's only one day, but an everlasting day, without yesterday to precede it and without tomorrow to follow it, not brought forth by the natural sun, which shall exist no more, but by Christ, the Son of righteousness. What a wonderful experience awaits the believer. Amen. Conclusion. Stanford University psychologist Professor Philip Zimbardo coined the idea of time perspective. After more than 10 years of research, he found that people have six distinctive time perspectives. They are past positive, focus on the good old days, past successes and nostalgia, past negative, focus on regret and failure and all the things that went wrong, present hedonistic, living in the moment for pleasure, avoiding pain, seeking novelty and sensation, past fatalism, life is governed by outside forces, so it doesn't pay to plan. Future, focus on learning to work rather than play. Transcendental future, life begins after death of the mortal body. He found that Protestant Christians tend to have a high past positive time perspective and to live more in the future and the transcendental future. Surely it's because our hope in the future of the coming of Christ so eloquently portrayed in this chapter by Peter. Now, there's a story told of Dr. Joseph Storwell, the president of Moody Bible Institute, as he visited a home for mentally handicapped children. And while he was walking through the corridor, he noticed that the windows were covered with little tiny handprints. He asked the director what they were all about. And the director replied, "The children have a love for Jesus. They are so eager for him to return that they lean against the windows and look up to the sky. As believers, we lean against the window of the transcendental future. Life begins after death of the mortal body and looks up to the sky. Jesus is coming back. Let us encourage one another with these words that Jesus is coming back. Looking back over the treasures that are deposited in these epistles of Peter, it's no wonder that these two letters are amongst the most treasured and most read by the church. There are many things that draws a person to read 1st and 2nd Peter. Certainly Peter's association with the Lord, which he mentions from time to time, drawing us irresistibly to the passages, to these letters, with a deep intent to capture the full meaning of Peter's words. Yet what most compelling in the letters is Peter's openness, his frankness as he deals with the Christian life. Peter writes as a man who has not only experienced life, but a man who has a firm grip on the reality of life, and under the anointing of the Holy Spirit gives both an encouragement and instruction to us to complete our pilgrimage in Christ.